Because we had a break between lectures, so let me briefly remind where we stopped on the previous time. So we aimed to build all representation for the Heisenberg group and investigate this representation. And we discuss a certain form which allows to produce a representation as a collection of certain bounded operators in linear space. And one of the standard representation which can be considered for any group is the left shift representation, when you consider group itself, function, define it on this group, and you act on these functions by means of the left shift. But the issue with this representation is what it's really enormous. Practically any representation may be realized as a sub-representation of the left regular representation, and so we want to have certain smaller part corresponding to possibly irreducible components of this representation. And in order to restrict our general left regular representation to smaller subspace, we consider function which have certain covariant property. So namely for particular subgroup and character of this subgroup, we consider function such what right shift of these functions produce multiplication in the range. So right shift on domain produce multiplication on the range of function. And because left and right shifts on any group commute, then that space of function will be invariant under left shift. So such function will make sub-representation. And for this sub-representation, we may pass to some model on the corresponding homogeneous space. So I remind what we take again group subgroup H, which is a closed subgroup in order to preserve the topology, and then we use this diagram to transfer action of our group from group G by left shift to the certain action on corresponding homogeneous space G over H. For induced representation, we can adopt that particular scheme as follows. We consider two maps which we will call lifting. Lifting act on functions defined on the homogeneous space and transfer them to functions which are defined on the group and has the previous covariant property. In order to perform such a lifting, we just make the following amendment. So we, for any element of the group G, we split that element in some unique way, which has a part which corresponds to homogeneous space. So then our function f small defined to homogeneous space can take corresponding value, so we adjust the domain of function, and remainder of element G, map RG, will be used in character in the range of our function. So it's easy to verify what function lifted in this way to the group will have the required covariant property on the group. And similarly, we want to have a map defined in opposite direction, a map which pick up a function on the group. Well, actually, it can be applied to any function on the group in this form, but if it's applied to a function with a given H covariant property, then that map, although it reduces the domain of function from group to homogeneous space, because function has covariant property, no loss of information occur in this way for this pooling, that map P pooling, And it's easy to verify what for functions with covariant property, actually that will be inverse maps. So this is a bijection if we restrict our attention just to function with covariant property. And then we may again have a diagram, now a diagram for representations similar to what we had before on the action on the group. So we consider space of a function which defined on the group. We lift such a function to function having covariant property to the group, and then apply the left shift. So that will be again a function in the same space with the covariant property which we described, and then we pull down this function to a function on the homogeneous space. So if everything here will be counted carefully together, the formula explicitly for this representation in term of homogeneous space can be written down in this expression. So as soon as we have group, subgroup, and then character of this subgroup, that formula is almost uniquely defined. We have certain freedom, kind of arbitrariness, to define this map S section which embed our homogeneous space intergroup, but this choice, that freedom which we have here, is not very significant. Actually, different sections, if we will pick up different sections, we will obtain equivalent pictures. So there is a statement what we can make with unitary operators which pull, which transform, intertwine one representation obtained from one section to a representation obtained from a second section. So that choice is just matter of certain convenience, especially with respect to our computation, but it's not a significant difference between this representation which appears in this way. So let us see how this scheme works. So here it will be good to compare with the previous action on the homogeneous spaces which we have. So I will pick up my calculation which we did before. So we consider first the subgroup H being the center of the group. So the decomposition here of an arbitrary element of the Heisenberg group is as follows, which we will use it. So that suggests what our section S will put a point of homogeneous space XY to the element 0XY, and S 0, 0, this is map R, that reminder which correspond to our subgroup, central subgroup. So everything from this decomposition is set up for building our representation, and then previous formula, if we will put together formula from previous slide, will produce such a representation which we will link soon to the Fock-Siegel-Bargmann representation in quantum mechanics. And again, you may compare with action 20 and on previous consideration. So we have the same Euclidean commutative simple shift on the group itself. So some numberings are changed here because I'm modifying my presentation continuously. So printout was done earlier, so it was number 20, now it's number 21 in this formula. So we have just Euclidean shift on the plane here as the action in corresponding set, and that reminder act through the following characters which include this symplectic form. So again, At the moment that formula may look a little bit complicated, we will spend time investigating that important von Siegel-Badman representation in details later. What will happen if we will consider the second one-dimensional subgroup, which is not equivalent, not conjugated to the center, when the decomposition in this case may be taken like that? So we have point 0x0 from our subgroup, and that two components in the center and component y can be taken as two points coordinates in two-dimensional homogeneous space. So again, placing everything, we will obtain a formula which looks rather different, maybe from a previous one, something we have more complicated action on the domain and less tricky action in the place of characters. So again, you may compare with the transformation which we have on homogeneous space. It's just used here in the action on the domain. Then coming to the next case of two-dimensional subgroups, this is subgroup of element S0y, which we consider it. Again, we pick up a decomposition of element of the Heisenberg group, which in most simplest way separate our homogeneous space and subgroup, and then pick up a character which take an account only S part from the subgroup. So Y seems to be not affecting this character. Again, we will discuss soon, is it a big loss for representations, construction of representation or not, if Y is not participating in this character. And then we build a corresponding representation in this way. Again, if you will compare with the action on the domain, it was just shift on the real line, so it's here acting on the variable of our function. On the other hand, that simple action on the domain is compensated a rather involved expression for the character in the range of function. Actually, what we will obtain here will be identified soon as the Schrödinger representation of the Heisenberg group. So this is the second important, or this is the first important model to construct quantum mechanical system. The Fock-Siegel-Bergmann, which we consider it first, historically appeared afterward. So Schrödinger representation was historically the first one. Well, we constructed this representation in term of homogeneous space, but we may also look on the corresponding action on the group, and then lifting and pulling representing these maps, they are provided by the formulas here 35, 37. So it's possible to check what formulas which we obtained before is just implication obtained for this lifting and pulling and corresponding left shift on the Heisenberg group. It's interesting to take a look on the induced representation related to the discrete subgroup of the Heisenberg group, which we described before. As I explained at the point where we introduced this discrete subgroup, the difference is with previous cases is not only what we have discrete subgroup in contrast to the continuous subgroups which was before, but this subgroup is also non-commutative. But if you will calculate commutator of all possible elements on this subgroup, you will see what value of the commutator produce an integer on the S part of the Heisenberg group. So it will be an integer because we have here integer values for x and y parts in the Heisenberg group. Commutator will reduce to certain symplectic form from integers, and symplectic form from integers will be integer value itself. So if I will pick up the following character of my subgroup, again it's take an account only on the S part from the subgroup, then for integer value 2 pi I m and integer S prime, that value produces the 1. So effectively commutator for this subgroup will be trivialized by this character. So in from point of view of this character, our group became commutative. Commutator is not seen. And so, since we have here the character, one-dimensional, we may, of given subgroup, we can build an induced representation. So, let's first discuss what would be covariance property with respect to this subgroup. So, we are doing on the right shifts by integers n and k, and then we see what value of function shall be multiplied by this character. As you can receive, we are used here not standard form of the Heisenberg group, but polarized form, so somehow calculation became simpler in this expression. So shift by n really does not change values of our function, as it's seen, so it's periodic in x variable, and shift in y part produce multiplication by such a constant in term of y, so this is a constant in term of y. So having these two properties, we may summarize saying what our functions covariance properties here reduced to periodicity in variable x and quasi-periodicity in variable y. So that is type of functions which we obtain on the group. Then calculation of the map R will be as follows. So for the element SXY, we have to take integer parts of X and Y. So because our subgroup contain only integers in these respective parts of the Heisenberg group, and to have a right decomposition here, decomposition is that formula 24, now well it's 25. So from this decomposition it's seen how the map R shall look like. Then we evaluate what will be the character from the remainder of SXY. So here again came into account certain periodicity and integer integrality of variables. So we have integrality of certain numbers, and due to periodicity of a character, so it's exponent of 2 pi I, exponent with imaginary parameter is periodic, 2 pi periodic, so we may replace value of character by some simpler expression. So instead of fractional part of x, we may just substitute x itself. And then placing everything together, we get the formula 39 as an expression for the action of our subgroup on corresponding homogeneous space. Again, because we are factorizing the Heisenberg group with respect to certain lattice generated by integers, result will be a homogeneous space. Resulting homogeneous space will be two-dimensional torus. So it will be a two-dimensional torus, a bugle, and function shall be expressed either acting on it, so we consider parameter on the torus belonging to interval 0, 1, so then we need to put integer fractional parts of variables here, or we may think about functions on the two-dimensional torus as double periodic on the R2. In this case, we may drop, if we are operating double periodic function, we may drop that fractional parts. As you can see, for this group, discrete subgroup, integer and fractional part of number start to play important role, and this is the reason why corresponding construction related to theta function appears on many occasions in number theory. So really one of the mysterious feature of Heisenberg group, what from one side it's important model, or it provides a model for the quantum mechanics, one of the most advanced applied physical picture of the world. On the other hand, the same Heisenberg group play important role for the number theory, one of the poorest mathematical theories. So somehow the same object spawned the bridge between most applicable and most theoretical parts of science. So somehow that equation which puzzled many researchers, including George Mackey, who contributed to the theory of the induced representation and studied that question related to the Heisenberg group, and I believe there is still here questions to think about for all of us. So there is something interesting happened behind the Heisenberg group. So, okay, that is quite a lot of different representation from different subgroups which we have induced. Probably at this point everyone will be confused by the number of this representation, by their appearance, and natural question is how to classify them, how to make certain order, and we will see in fact what there is a very beautiful and precise description what are possible representation of the Heisenberg group. And as usually in mathematics, to make a classification, we do it, we make it up to certain equivalence. And for unitary representation, the natural language of equivalence would be for will be with the usage of certain unitary operator, so we will call such operator intertwining if we may, if we can map a space of one representation to the space of another representation in such a way what this unitary operator U intertwine them. So this is equivalence condition, or the second form to write down that equivalence condition will be as follows. So if we will have the identity what rho U is equal U rho tilde, so just using what our representation is intertwined here by some invertible operator, we can put it in this way. So just using similarity, similarity in the sense of operator theory between two representations. So that will be equivalent form. And then the theory of automorphism for the group which we already considered give a suggestion. So we already mentioned what for the any group we may consider so-called inner automorphism when element G ascend element G prime to the element G inverse G prime G, then if we apply the representation to such a transformation, then a representation of G prime will go to the representation of this product. But representation is a group homomorphism, so for this reason we may split this product into such a product of operator representing G, or we may put it as U inverse rho G prime U, where U is just simply rho of G. So inner automorphism on any group transform a representation to a certain representation. So if I will call my rho tilde of G prime to be just representation rho of that transformed G prime, so then I have the intertwining, natural intertwining operator between representation rho tilde and rho. So inner automorphism always produce intertwining operators. So in this way, it help identify certain representation. And this is a starting point for so-called method of orbits by Kirillov. So let us investigate or briefly describe that method in a reasonable generality. So we pick up a group G, a Lie group, and we are concentrated here just on particular form of groups which have a matrix form. So this is a subgroup of general linear group of order n. So in particular, we discuss what Heisenberg group can be written in this form as L to R, and many other groups may be written in this form as a subgroup of general linear group of order n. Then the Lie algebra of this Lie group will be a tangent space at identity for the given group, for the element identity element of our group. The inner automorphism called here by A act in the formula which we already discussed. So because it's an automorphism of the group, it sent identity element to the identity element. And so it's transform a vector from the tangent space in the identity element to some tangent, to some other tangent vector at the identity element. So instead of that inner automorphism, we consider so-called adjoint action of a group on corresponding elements of Lie algebra thought as the corresponding tangent vectors. And in this way, we obtain a representation of our group G by this adjoint action. Well, this is a rather general construction. If our group is constructed as the group of certain matrices, when its Lie algebra is also construct may be realized as certain matrices, and then that adjoint action is very naturally represented again just a product of corresponding matrices. You pick up a matrix which correspond to element G, you pick up matrix which correspond to element B of the Lie algebra, you make this product, and that will be a joint action. So that is what instead of that previous general theory we may use for our particular calculation. So in matrix form it's rather simple, it's matrix conjugation what we obtain. Now for induction, when we are inducing representation from a character, a natural way to build a character of one parameter subgroup is just to take an element from the dual space to a Lie algebra. Dual space that is linear functional. So if for element x in my Lie algebra I have a functional, so where pairing will produce a number. So, and then for this number I take exponent of 2 pi I t, and that will be a character of one parameter subgroup, just using the property of exponent, because exponent is a map which is group homomorphism from additive group of reals to multiplicative group of positive reals. So we obtain a natural character of our one parameter subgroup. So induction of representation is depend on such element from the dual to the Lie algebra. Again, if our group is realized as matrices, then the dual space can be naturally again identified with matrices through the natural pairing between matrices. Natural pairing between matrices is given by the trace of the product of matrices. So that is the pairing of matrices A and B. And in this way, if our group, a Lie algebra, can be represented as matrices, the dual space can be also represented as matrices. But we don't need to consider all matrices if we have just subgroup. So we need to factor out certain orthogonal complements. So practically, we need to factor out matrices which annihilate, which are orthogonal to all matrices from the Lie algebra. So if we have such orthogonal projection parallel to orthogonal complement to G, then the so-called Kirillov action or coadjoint representation of our group G in term of the previous expression for matrices will be given as follows. So linear functional on the Lie algebra represented by a matrix F capital, we conjugate it with the matrix corresponding to element G, and then doing the projection parallel to the orthogonal complement. So by the discussion which we had before, if our representation rho, which we have here, is induced by an element F from the dual to the Lie algebra, then by coadjoint action we get the representation which induced by some equivalent element. So that means what action on coadjoint orbits by group G transform one induced representation to equivalent one. So representation generated by such characters appears to be equivalent. So let us see how that previous general construction, that induced representation and method of orbits, is a big interesting topic in the group theory itself. So I just make a brief sketch of the general construction, but we are working with very particular group, with the group Heisenberg group, so let us see how it's act in our case. So as we already discussed, element G of the group can be represented as such 3 times 3 matrix. So that is a matrix representing our group. And element from the Lie algebra, again, we already discussed it, can be represented as such matrix B. Then if we calculate the conjugation of B with the matrix G, so again, it's just simple matrix multiplication, that will be the following result. So we can get a matrix with coadjoint action. Now, in term of element, so as we put it before, for elements in our Lie algebra, components are S, X, and Y, and after conjoint action, they were transformed into, this is for X, this is for Y, this is not changed, and this is how component S have been changed. So if I will think about this component SXY as a column vector, the same transformation is just presented by this action on matrices. So you may just verify what this action of S here is just a product of this column, this row to this column. So if you multiply, you just get that value as it appears in the upper triangular, upper right corner of this matrix, and all other X and Y are preserved, so on the diagonal we have one. So this is what we have as in term of action on the vectors. And now this is action on the Lie algebra. On the dual space, we need to take the adjoint matrix for this one. Adjoint matrix is done just by transposition. So we need to transpose this matrix, and it will be an action on the corresponding dual space. So let us introduce coordinates on the dual space to the Lie algebra of the Heisenberg group. So that will be given in physical notation. So dual to variable S will be denoted as a Planck constant, H. Dual to X will be denoted as Q, coordinate in physical terms, and dual to Y will be denoted as P, momentum. So coadjoint action is given by the transpose matrix, and that coadjoint action will be like that. So it's just, and you take the transpose matrix and look what it's happened. You will see what coadjoint action on this things will be as follow. So Planck constant H is not changed by coadjoint action, so there is no effect by of coadjoint action on H, but Q and P are transformed proportionally to X and Y in a skew way. So but a coefficient of proportionality is equal to Planck constant H itself. So if Planck constant is non-zero, we can really choose suitable X and Y to make second and third component in our vector to be equal to zero. So we always, for non-zero Planck constant, we may by coadjoint action reduce our character to a character which is just Planck constant 0, 0. This is why I choose only these corresponding characters in the previous induced representation when we build representations of the Heisenberg group. So you can see for next one here for this subgroup. Potentially the most general character for our group will be here as follows. So most general character will be depend on Planck constant and parameter P. So that will be acting on S0 Y as E 2 pi I H times S plus P times Y. So that will be most general character which I can imagine for the corresponding subgroup. But by coadjoint action, P can be replaced by zero, and it will be the corresponding just equivalent representation as we discussed before. So for this reason, that part is not necessary, and we just may stick with the character which was already considered. So in this way, we obtained most general representation which is possible up to equivalence in term of a simpler character. Picture, we may visualize that representation theory as follows. So representations of the Heisenberg group are induced by characters of one parameter subgroups. all these characters depends on three numbers, Planck constant, Q and P, and when previous action which we have here telling what for a hyperplane with the fixed h make a single orbit, so all characters on this bluish plane is really produce equivalent representation. So all that characters on this hyperplane just correspond to a representation with one particular value of Planck constant, which is different from zero. Is a positive or negative? This is the same. If Planck constant is equal to zero, coadjoint action became trivial on this thing. Every point is fixed. So, and it's quite natural from physical term to identify that hyperplane, a greenish one with Planck constant equal to zero, with the classical phase space, which parameterized by coordinate and momentum. So, but we will, at the end of the course, we will see even better picture of relation between classical and quantum mechanics. Here, what, how that representation theory may be interpreted to some point, what non-zero Planck constant here, this is the bold blue line representation, and a representation which correspond to non-zero Planck constant, give a quantum mechanical system, while Planck constant equal to zero produce a classical system. And as you see, in some sense of geometry, topology which we have here, that classical phase space is the limiting point of the quantum picture when Planck constant tends to zero. So this is very tempting to speak about relation between classical and quantum mechanics in this term, in term of representation of the Heisenberg group. But again, at the end of the course, I will present some alternative picture that may be even more attractive with, in some sense. If we start to discuss physical language and physical picture for our construction, I will make even more advances to the area of physics and to be correct in terms of measurements and units of measurements. So let us introduce some units for measuring mass, length and time. And then it's common in physics what we cannot add seconds with kilograms or meters with seconds. So this is a different physical units expression which contain summation of such differently physical object is just physically a nonsense. If you change a system of your measurements from international to imperial, then just all expression which are not correct in term of units, when you add different physical units, we just will lost their sense. So, but if you are adding just masses to masses and velocities to velocities, then a change of physical units is will be just rescaling. So that will be quite meaningful. So, as such, if we, for example, think about exponent in term of its Taylor expansion, it came out what a variable u here shall be dimensionless. Otherwise, if it has any dimensionality, in physical dimensionality, then u and u squared and u cubed and so on, they will be of different dimensionality if we are not dimensionless. So we cannot define really mathematical function of anything which has a physical units. So that is, again, a very simple observation. So when we are trying to use an expression as exponent of x times q, that means what dimensionality of x and q shall be reciprocal. So if, say, x measure it in meters, then q shall be measured in reciprocal to meters, 1 divided by meter, something like that. Otherwise, that function will not be well defined. And so, we, in mind of physical application, for the coordinate on the Heisenberg group, we assign the following units. For x and y, we say what this is reciprocal to the units of length, and y is reciprocal to the units of momentum. For momentum is length time mass divided by time, so y is time divided by length time mass. And because s component used a product of x and y, so measurement for s shall be t divided by length squared root m square m. And this is reciprocal to the units of action, physical term. And if we assign such units to element of the Heisenberg group, then elements of the dual to the Lie algebra, which we defined before, again in physical terms, will get the just natural physical measurements. Q will be measured as a length, so P will be, so its coordinate. P will be measured in units of momentum, and H, a Planck constant, will be measured in the product of length and momentum, which is action, as it shall be. So Planck constant is measured as in units of the action. And we will take care what all subsequent formulas, will be physically meaningful, so that will follow the rules which are specified on this slide in physical term. Okay, it's time to finish our lecture today. Do you have questions?